Super Dimensional Fortress Macross 2, Lovers Again, is a 6-episode OVA taking place in the Macross universe, but it's better known to me, and likely many other 90s kids, as Super Dimensional Fortress Macross 2, The Movie, which was confusing to my fragile child brain because The Movie is usually a title given to the first filmed adaptation of a TV show, but this clearly had a 2 in it, like it was a sequel, and at the time, I wasn't aware of the existence of Macross Do You Remember Love. In fact, the only reason I knew what Macross was is because I remember seeing it in the ending credits of episodes of Robotech I watched as a kid. Where was I going with this? Oh, right. When I first watched Macross 2 Lovers Again, I loved it. I'm aware that it has many flaws and that its very existence was amputated from canon. I can't control that the nostalgia tickles my brain, though. In the ancient times that were my youth, I was exposed to the world of Macross via Robotech, brought to us Americans by the evil that is Harmony Gold. I believe I must include a fuck Harmony Gold in this video, as it's kind of like the "and the peace be with you" for Macross fans. Robotech was all I knew, and I loved it. I vividly remember anticipating each episode in my younger years. I was completely engrossed in the story, the characters, the designs, and even the charming yet sometimes inconsistent budget animation when it showed up from time to time. After what seemed to be the conclusion of the story, I remember being excited when I discovered that there was a new season of Robotech that was coming to my TV screens via Cartoon Network. I couldn't wait to see where the show was going to go next, especially because it seemed like all the story threads had wrapped up at the end. Then...
what the hell is even that?
Needless to say, to those of you familiar with Macross vs. Robotech and its strange rights situations in the United States, I figured out that this was not actually taking place in the same universe as the show I had fallen in love with. It was an entirely different show that had been repurposed by Harmony Gold to try to fool us dumb Westerners into spending some more money on more Robotech.
But Scott's armored cyclone can move out real fast if he can get back soon enough. Korg's in for a blast.
Don't worry, Ram. My armored cyclone will stop him.
Robotech, Invid Shock Trooper, Cyclone, and action figures, each sold separately. New from Matchbox.
So, I moved on with my life, accepting that the story really was over. That is until one day, when I was browsing the anime VHS section of a now long-gone mall fixture called Record Town, I stumbled across this. I remembered this word Macross showing up in the credits of Robotech, vaguely aware that this was the proper name of the show in Japan, and saw the recognizable Valkyrie on the cover. I thought to myself, there is a sequel to the show, and it's
The Movie.
I immediately bought it, rushed home, and jammed it into my VCR. And then...
that was awesome!
For the uninitiated, the story of Macross 2 Lovers Again takes place 80 years after the events of Macross Do You Remember Love, which itself was a condensed retelling of the events of the Macross TV show that Americans knew as Robotech. If you're confused yet, you're probably not alone. And it also takes place 10 years after there was any real fighting between the humans and the Zentradi. Instead of a hotshot young pilot, our protagonist this time around is a hotshot young reporter named Tobiki Kanzaki. He gets into some hot water with his employer after embarrassing the military, exposing what he believed to be a scandal involving a young Valkyrie pilot named Sylvie Gina and one of the higher-ups within the military.
Now, 話題の超美人。行こう。
Hibiki's boss lectures him about the importance of journalistic integrity and warns him that his career won't last long if his only goal is to chase ratings instead of the facts, which is obviously the opposite of how the real world works in 2022. This also draws him into conflict with the young ace pilot, but before she can completely chew him out, the military is called into action when an alien fleet enters the solar system. Based on the ship configurations, UN Spacey assumes that they're dealing with another group of Zentradi, unaware that what they are about to face is not quite the Emmy they're used to, but a new threat known as the Marduk. Hibiki, sensing his chance to score in the ratings and chase excitement as a war reporter, begs his boss for the chance to cover the battle. Hibiki is disappointed to discover that he won't be allowed to cover the story as a reporter, but because he has a Valkyrie license, he's allowed to chauffeur the grizzled veteran of the agency who has had a little too much to drink. As the battle begins, UN Spacey rolls out the usual Minmay tactic and finds some early success in the battle. Only discover that the Marduk have a defense against this that they hadn't anticipated. Songs of their own. These are the songs of the emulators, who helped the Marduk warriors focus and enhance their fighting ability, rendering the UN Spacey tactics of the past useless, and resulting in a humiliating defeat for Earth. Hibiki sees firsthand that covering war is not glorious and struggles with watching his people being slaughtered. He gains his resolve thanks to a pep talk from his colleague, and the two decide to fly into one of the enemy ships for a closer look. They stumble upon one of the emulators named Ishtar. She's unconscious and her ship is badly damaged on the verge of being destroyed. Unlike the Zentradi, Ishtar is no bigger than the average human. So, the two reporters decide to take Ishtar with them, a decision that unfortunately results in the death of the old grizzled reporter.
Dennis!
Hibiki! Fly, you fools!
Hibiki escapes with Ishtar and returns to Earth. The rest of the plot revolves around Hibiki teaching and exposing Ishtar to the human culture, showing her that it's worth saving. But here's the thing about Macross 2 Lovers Again. It's not the sequel I thought it was. In fact, it doesn't exist. It was rejected by the fanbase.
No. No, I don't think I will.
Was heavily criticized and finally considered non-canon to the Macross universe. But how and why? Well, that's difficult to explain unless you know all the ins and outs of what was going on with the franchise at the time, and the answer can be different depending on who you ask. There are people who say they dislike Macross 2 for plenty of reasons, but the reason that it was removed from the Macross continuity comes down to who made Macross 2, and, more importantly, who didn't.
The primary point of controversy regarding Macross 2 is that its development and production didn't include any input from Macross's original creators, Studio Nui and Soji Kawamori. It was developed by the company that technically owned the rights to the series, Big West, as a means to capitalize on the success of Macross Do You Remember Love. To oversimplify things, Kawamori had no interest in making more Macross at the time, but couldn't prevent the new OVA from being developed. Kawamori later returned to the franchise and was responsible for the stories for all Macross series that would follow. The events of Macross 2 didn't fit with his plans for future stories and was essentially replaced with Macross Delta. To put it in the words of a specific fan, traveling all the way back to a message board in 2007, Studio Nui and Kawamori were the creators of Macross. In order to get produced, you do often have to sell your rights, thus you have Big West. Studio Nui gets all the credit for creating Macross, but Big West, from my understanding, can decide to make all the Macross they want without the creator's input. Thus, you have Macross 2. I could buy all the rights to Star Wars from Lucas. Star Wars is mine. I can do anything I want with it. I could call my changes and additions as the official story. Even so, without using Lucas as a story consultant and Lucasfilm as co-producers, would people accept my Star Wars as official? They are official because I own it, but I didn't create it. Oh. Oh, 2007, Roy Focker. If only you knew what the future would bring.
Hey, Goofy.
Disney. Fucking Disney. Of course you know. I got Mickey Mouse ears on my fucking dog's ear.
At the end of the day, its place in canon doesn't impact my ability to enjoy it. To me, in 1996, this was the continuation of Macross. It was all there was. And I was too young to understand the political, creative, or production nuances to what was going on anyway. And on that note, I'm here to defend Macross 2. It's pretty fucking great. Yes, the story is predictable, and that's probably putting it kindly. Yes, the characters are not as memorable as SDF Macross, and yes, the ending was rushed, and the animation and the story both suffered greatly because of this. I get all that. But you know what else it has? Moments like this. Also, one of the criticisms I happened to read a couple of times while researching this is that the music in Macross 2 is forgettable compared to the previous incarnations. But just listen to this theme and tell me that it's not on par with some of the greatest anime intros of the 80s and 90s. I understand that my love for Macross 2 is biased thanks to nostalgia, but I don't think it's out of line to say that it gets more hate than it really deserves. If you can take a step back from the greater Macross lore and take it for what it is, I feel there's a lot to enjoy here. Its greatest flaws are rooted in the fact that it was born from the minds of a different creative team and suffered from a rushed production schedule. All things considered, the end result was a competent and fun Macross adventure, even if it wasn't terribly original or special. In fact, watching it again after several years reminded me just how much I enjoyed Macross as a franchise, motivating me to revisit the series and catch up on all the things I've missed since I stopped paying attention to it. It had the bonus effect of transporting me back to my childhood, like all good nostalgia trips do, when everything was ahead of me and I had all the time in the world. Considering recent events in my life since I began writing this review, that's a very welcoming feeling, even if it's only for a moment. If you aren't familiar with Macross, do yourself a favor and give this a watch under the premise that this is an anime of the popcorn flick variety. I think you'll find yourself having some fun.
If you are a fan of Macross, there probably isn't much I can say that would change your opinion on Macross 2 other than to say, don't you want to just have a little mindless fun? Who cares if it fits with the rest of the established universe? Sometimes we all need to just have a little goddamn fun.